Knowing the Truth with Pastor Kevin Boling is a live call-in radio program providing doctrinal dialogue, cultural commentary, and insightful interviews with some of today's foremost Christian authors and leaders. Knowing the Truth is the outreach ministry of the Mountain Bridge Bible Fellowship, located on Highway 25 in Traveler's Rest. The goal of the church and the radio program is to seek the glory of God in the salvation of sinners and the sanctification of the saints by the ministry of the Word. For more information, go to www.knowingthetruth.org. Here with today's edition of Knowing the Truth is Pastor Kevin Boling.
Well, welcome into this edition of the Knowing the Truth radio broadcast. This is Pastor Kevin Boling. So glad that you joined us on the broadcast today. Well, according to Charisma News, came out yesterday, they said 3 million people watched the evolution creation debate. But how many minds were changed? That's what they ask in the article. They write this, and this again was yesterday that it came out. It said a minimum of 3 million viewers watched last night's evolution creation debate between Bill Nye, the science guy, and Ken Ham, founder of the Creation Museum, which was the location of the much discussed event. Obviously, a number of people have been talking about this event, and there was actually another follow-up broadcast last night in which Ken Ham did from the Creation Museum again. I think he brought in some of the other folks that were on staff there. And somebody mentioned to me before the broadcast that that they actually estimate that it was probably over, conservatively, over 5 million people that had watched the original broadcast of the debate. I think first and foremost, we've got to say that the Creation Museum, Ken Ham, and the folks that are there should be commended for the job that they did. I thought it was very professionally done. I thought the moderator from CNN did an excellent job. There was very little technical difficulties. I think there was one clip that they tried to play that had a little bit of trouble in the clip. So I think that first and foremost, they should be really commended for an outstanding job that they did of putting that debate on. Now, there was one question that I was thinking about during the debate that I am going to follow up on during the broadcast today. And that question was, I was wondering what the folks that that hold to an intelligent design position, I would love to get their assessment of the debate. And who better to do that with than Dr. Stephen Meyer? And so Dr. Meyer has been so kind in order to come on the broadcast today to talk about, you know, what his assessment is and maybe some of the things that maybe he would have included if he was involved in that debate or that we should think about afterwards and so forth. Let me just say that Dr. Stephen Meyer is the director of the Center for Science and Culture at the Discovery Institute. You can go out to his webpage. There's www.stephenmeyer.org. That's www.stephenmeyer.org to find out more about his work. And you can also go out to the Discovery Institute page as well. And that website is www.discovery.org. For those of you watching via sermon audio today, you'll actually see a clip about Dr. Stephen Meyer at the end of this broadcast today. We'll go ahead and air that at during the break at the end of the broadcast, at the end of our interview. Dr. Meyer, so great to have you back on the Knowing the Truth radio broadcast.
It's great to be with you, Kevin.
Dr. Meyer, what was your assessment? Let me just open it up, wide open question there, but just your thoughts of the debate the other night.
Well, it was obviously, you know, it generated an awful lot of interest in the issue of biological origins, and I think that's a plus. We've had a tremendous amount of traffic to our sites and books and all kinds of things just because of the increased interest in the issue. I think the overall way in which the debate was framed it was a mirror image of the stereotype we get of the debate in the media, which is that the debate is a contest between two extreme positions, one the Darwinian materialism and the other the young earth version of creationism, with no positions in the middle. And I think that's in some ways unfortunate, because I think the theory of intelligent design doesn't really take a position on the age of the Earth, but at the same time, we're also think it's important to focus on more fundamental issues in the debate, because the crucial issue is that arises because of Darwinian evolution is the question of whether or not there is any design or evidence of design, and therefore a designer, any evidence of design in the universe, and therefore any evidence of a designer at all. And while the mainstream scientific establishment has been pushing essentially a materialistic understanding of origins, which denies any role for any kind of designer or creator of any kind, there's been this ongoing intramural debate within the Christian Church about how long ago the creation took place. And Kent Ham's group has really made their bread and butter by focusing on the defense of a young Earth, where I think which I think is probably the least significant issue in play in the overall debate. And I think it's also the place where the scientific evidence for that position is weakest. There's incredibly strong evidence against the neo-Darwinian theory of evolution, which is the standard textbook theory of evolution. And I address a lot of that in my book, Darwin's Doubt, and we've talked about that on air before.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's also incredibly strong evidence for intelligent design. And Ken Ham mentioned in passing that one of the consequences of a biblical view is that you should expect to see such evidence.
Mm-hmm.
But the debate focused largely on this question of the age of the Earth, where Christians themselves disagree, and by that I mean biblical Christians disagree on that. And I think he therefore presented, the debate kind of presented a false dichotomy, as if that was these were the only two positions in play: materialistic Darwinism and young Earth creationism. And it also, I think, falsely emphasized that as the critical issue, which I think it clearly isn't. It's obviously more important whether or not there is evidence for a creator. Some of your listeners may remember the wonderful book by Lee Strobel a couple of years ago called Case for the Creator.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the more fundamental issue than how long ago the creation might have taken place.
Mm-hmm. Did you hear then anything during the debate? You made mention to the fact that Ken Ham made some sort of a comment towards design. I don't have a clip available or even the quote from it, but I seem to remember Bill Nye during the debate giving some sort of a defense from a naturalist position as to why design is seen in some of the material that they're looking at. And I thought that there was even something where he alluded to the idea again about the design could have come from somewhere else, comets or aliens or something along that line. I don't think he used the word alien. But did you hear any of that in the debate as well?
Well, that went by a little fast, but kind of the point is there really wasn't much focus on that really central issue. I mean, if you go back to Darwin's theory in 1859 and to all the defenses that have been made of what is called neo-Darwinism, which is the modern version of Darwinian theory, which emphasizes natural selection acting on random mutations. Darwin didn't know about mutations in his time. And he didn't know about genes, for that matter. But in modern neo-Darwinism, the updated version of the theory explicitly denies that there's evidence of actual design in the universe. Richard Dawkins, for example, has said that that biology, from a neo-Darwinian point of view, is the study of complicated things that give the appearance of having been designed for a purpose.
Yeah.
And this is the key central proposition. Another leading biologist, Francisco Ayala, says that Darwinism explains design without a designer. And this
mm-hmm.
is what Nye was alluding to. Now that is an incredibly important proposition from a worldview standpoint,
mm-hmm.
because if there's no design, no actual design, and no evidence of an actual designer, then it follows that the simplest explanation of how we got here is actually completely materialistic. It follows that the neo-Darwinian mechanism is purely unguided and undirected.
Mm-hmm.
This is the problem that many of us in the ID movement also have with our theistic evolutionary colleagues, is that they want to treat Darwinian evolution as if it were worldview neutral, as if it were theologically neutral, when in fact it is, by implication, affirming that a purely materialistic, undirected process produced everything, and that there is, as Richard Dawkins says, no need for a creator, and as he goes on and says further, it makes it possible to be an intellectually fulfilled atheist. Now, that to us is the really key proposition that needs to be argued,
mm-hmm.
and by focusing so much energy on the issue of the age of the Earth, we've really let these rascals on the materialist side of the argument get a free pass. And mm-hmm. and so for me, I think with all the attention that was effectively brought to the issue, there was a huge missed opportunity in not focusing on the central issue and not making the really powerful arguments there now are for intelligent design and against this neo-Darwinian materialistic perspective.
There were a couple questions during the debate that I was curious if ID addresses as at all. One of the questions came for Bill Nye as to where did the material come from before the Big Bang? And then there was another one associated with that where they talked about the idea of life coming from something that was dead. So you got these rocks, and basically you're saying that everything, once those rocks exploded, suddenly life was formed through that. And then one other one associated with that was the idea of consciousness. And he was asked, where did consciousness come from then? Does ID address any of those issues?
Yeah, all of the above. I mean, these are really important issues. I mean, if you start, and this is, again, unfortunate, the young Earth focus on the age of the Earth question has made many young Earth creationists diffident to the really powerful evidence there is for a definite beginning to the universe. And this evidence has come under the heading of the Big Bang theory, and I think a lot of Christian people unfortunately misunderstand what the cosmologists are talking about with the Big Bang. They're not saying the Big Bang caused the universe to come into existence. They're saying the Big Bang is the first event or the first effect, which from a materialistic standpoint is completely unexplained. In fact, I think that the new cosmology, and however long ago you date that origin of the universe event, the new cosmology is pointing to the need for a cause which transcends matter, space, time, and energy. In other words, it's implying that it's the picture that we get of the early universe is very similar to what the medieval theologians described when they talked about the doctrine of creatio ex nihilo, creation out of nothing physical.
Right.
So we have a huge development in physics and cosmology, which is very friendly to a creationist perspective in the broad sense, where we're not focusing solely on the time issue. And many people who have been so focused on making the case that the Earth and the universe is young have overlooked the really powerful implications of this theory that are extremely friendly to theism, so much so that they've caused a lot of angst and heartburn among cosmologists and physicists who had heretofore held to a materialistic or naturalistic worldview in which they assumed that matter and energy were eternal and self-existent. I think the new cosmology implies just the opposite. And it was very, I thought, ironic in the debate to have Bill Nye sort of hanging the Big Bang theory around Ken Ham's neck, when really anyone arguing for design, and in this case, actually, I think a kind of transcendent design, which is awfully close to the idea of creatio ex nihilo. This is something that really the theistic side should be arguing, the agnostic materialist side has typically been very, very loath to want to really face the implications of all of this. So, and there are many people in the ID movement who have made that case. Lee Strobel, again, in his book, The Case for Creator, has a wonderful chapter on it, featuring the work of the Christian scholar William Lane Craig, who's done fantastic work showing that the new developments in physics and cosmology revive the ancient cosmological argument for the existence of God.
During the debate as well, Ken Nye mentioned the name Carl Sagan, and Nye, I think, positioned himself as a protege of Carl Sagan. If I remember right,
if I could interrupt, Kevin, that's again ironic because Sagan was known for that famous statement at the beginning of his Cosmos series.
I was just going to quote that.
Said, the universe is all there is and all there was and all there ever will be. It's almost a materialist variant on an ancient Christian creed.
Yes.
But the odd thing, again, is that both general relativity and the evidence from observational cosmology, the evidence of an expanding universe, which implies that if you wind the time sequence backwards, you get to a definite beginning of the expansion, and therefore, essentially, an event which is documenting the creation of the universe, and that the universe was not eternal and self-existent, as Sagan said. Nye is positioning himself as the science popularizer of Carl Sagan. He is clearly defending a materialistic, naturalistic worldview that has no place in it for a creator of any kind, and yet he's also wanting to criticize Ken Ham for not accepting the Big Bang, and I would say that those tables could have easily been turned and said, hey, the Big Bang has implications that directly challenge your worldview, and that was an argument left unmade.
Yeah, I thought during the event as well that there was a lot of points that could have been drilled down upon, and really made a very strong statement back to Bill Nye on some of the things that he had said. Let me remind our listening audience, we're speaking with Dr. Stephen Meyer. Dr. Meyer is the director of the Center for Science and Culture at the Discovery Institute. Let me open up the phone line there real quick and just say that if you want to call in with a quick question for Dr. Meyer before the end of the hour, we'll go ahead and try to get a call or two in. The number here is 1-888-660-WLFJ. That's 1-888-660-9535. That's 1-888-660-9535. If you've got a quick question about the subject of intelligent design or something about the creation debate the other day, we'll be happy to try to work that into the discussion. I mentioned a couple of websites. Dr. Meyer's website is stephenmeyer.org. That's www.stephenmeyer.org. And you can also go out to the Discovery Institute's website. And there you find all the information about books and other materials and so forth that you can get your hands on to further investigate some of these things that we're talking about. But that website is www.discovery.org. That's discovery.org. And you can go out there and find out all that information.
Answer the other question you asked about, which was about the issue of abiogenesis, how you get life from non-life.
Yeah, please do.
I've written two main books on these topics. One is called Signature in the Cell, and the other, Darwin's Doubt. And the first book, Signature in the Cell, addresses precisely this question of the origin of the first life. And this is, again, a place where the materialist, naturalist understanding of origins, in this case, the biological origins, the origin of the very first life, is incredibly weak and vulnerable. Almost all evolutionary theorists acknowledge that there is no adequate theory of the origin of the first life, how you get from simple chemicals to a living cell. And in Signature in the Cell, I argue that there is incredibly powerful evidence at that point in the history of life, in that point in the history of the cosmos, for intelligent design, because what we've discovered in biology in the last 50 years is that information is literally running the show, that there's a digital code stored in the DNA molecule that is necessary for producing all of the protein parts and molecular machines that cells need to stay alive, mm-hmm. and that the critical issue in the origin of life is the issue of the origin of that information. And that has turned out to be incredibly difficult for materialistic evolutionary theorists to explain. You look at, for example, any kind of message written on a piece of paper, you wouldn't explain the origin of the information in that message by the chemistry of the ink binding to the paper. There's something else involved, and what else is involved is the intelligence that arranged the letters in that message.
Yes.
And so you've got a very similar kind of argument in the case of the origin of the information necessary to life. And in fact, what we know from experience is that whenever we find information and we trace it back to its source, we always come to a mind not a, a material process. So the discovery that information is critical to the origin of the first life, and in my second book, Darwin's Doubt, I show that it's also critical to the origin of new forms of animal life and plant life as well. These are powerful discoveries that point decisively to intelligence. And it was one of the arguments that Ken Ham made in passing, or he made the point that you would expect from a theistic and a biblical point of view to see evidence of such intelligence, but he made very little of that, of the actual evidence for it. And that's something that is, in fact, a huge focus of the intelligent design research community, and it's been a huge focus of the two books that I've written.
The point in the debate where I thought it would be just perfect to enter into that discussion would have been where it was so ironic that Bill Nye found it so incredulous that people could build the Ark, and he kept talking about, you know, they didn't have any shipbuilding experience, it was only a few people, you know, it just... unreconcilable to him that they could get the animals on the Ark, and yet basically his position is that everything came from nothing. He doesn't seem to see the irony.
There is an irony there, because if you're saying, well, these intelligent designers weren't smart enough to build object X,
yes,
but then you want to affirm that everything could have arisen without any intelligent design at all.
Exactly.
I would think that by his own lights, that ought to be seen as a greater absurdity. But the mythology on the other side is that matter in motion, that simple chemicals have creative power that we in fact never see them demonstrating. That's one of the reasons that the origin of life is such a difficult problem, is that chemistry doesn't do what chemistry should do. The chemicals don't do what they would need to be able to do in order to generate these information-rich molecules that are necessary to life.
Mm.
And so what we know from experience is the opposite. There's only one known cause in all of the universe that's capable of generating information, especially information in a digital or alphabetic form.
Mm.
And that is essentially what we have in DNA. Francis Crick's famous sequence hypothesis was that there are four chemicals that run down the spine of the DNA molecule that are functioning just like alphabetic letters in a written text or digital characters in the machine code.
Mm.
And what we know from experience is that information of that kind always arises from an intelligent source. So that's, I think, the greatest vulnerability of the materialistic Darwinian position. And I don't think, unfortunately, that vulnerability was exploited in the debate the other night, because there was so much focus on this age question.
Hmm. Well, you have a very positive statement that is part of that video that plays on the StephenMeyer.org website. I jotted down a statement there and posted it the other day, but it says this. I titled it Darwin's Demise. But it says this, quote, the discovery of the information properties of DNA is a fundamental challenge to all materialistic theories of the origin of life. Neo-Darwinism and its associated theories of chemical evolution and the like will not be able to survive the biology of the information age, the biology of the 21st century. Boy, that gives us a lot of hope that Darwin is, on his last step here, if we can just turn to look at the information that is in the cell and in biology in general, right?
That's very well said. In my new book, Darwin's Doubt, I make the point that there is a huge disparity in the presentation, or in the status of, there's a huge disparity in the way in which the status of Darwinian theory is presented to the public by people like Bill Nye or Richard Dawkins or groups like the National Center for Science Education on the one hand, and the actual status of the modern version of Darwin's theory, neo-Darwinism, as you find it in the peer-reviewed technical literature within evolutionary biology. That is to say, leading evolutionary biologists and theorists are now very critical of the creative power of the mutation selection mechanism, the very thing which supposedly justifies the claim that there is no design and that instead what we see is design without a designer.
Mm.
And so that is a fundamental vulnerability in the theory, and I show why that's the case in the new book, Darwin's Doubt.
Mm. Well, Dr. Meyer, I want to give you the final word here, and if you'd like during this time to point our listeners to some other resources that specifically speak to what we've been addressing here today on your site, that would be just fine. But let me give you the final word here today on the interview.
Well, that's very kind of you, Kevin. I would direct readers, or listeners actually, to the site darwinsdoubt.com. The young techies in our office have created a YouTube channel there of debates that I've done and animations interviews with me and other of the fellows of the Discovery Institute Center for Science and Culture. And there's a lot of terrific resources there that I think would give people an understanding of how we would frame the issue and just how powerful the evidence actually is for a designer and therefore why people of faith, I think, should not be feeling on the defensive right now. We should be feeling that the evidence is supporting the viewpoint that we hold.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, I thought of another question as you were saying that. You mentioned that there is a number of debates out there. I imagine those debates are with Darwinianists or materialists. But is there any sort of debate then that is taking place between, you were saying that we've got this intramural struggle going on between the young Earth creationist versus folks that, like yourself, that are looking more at the data to prove the existence of a designer. Are there those types of debates taking place as well?
Yeah, the ID folks have tried mainly to stay out of that debate and focus the debate on these issues that we regard as more fundamental. And there are people within the ID movement that hold both views, both the old Earth and the young Earth view. Mm-hmm. But there, within the Christian community in particular, there have been debates between, and many of these have taken place in print, but I think there may have been some you know, recorded debates between people like Hugh Ross, who's an old Earth creationist, and people like Ken Ham or the folks at Answers in, or at the Institute for Creation Research, who are young Earth creationists.
Mm-hmm.
And I've actually participated in some behind-the-scenes meetings with representatives from the various different points of view. There are also another point of view within the Christian world is theistic evolution, and there are many different versions of that thesis as well. So there's a lot of interesting middle positions that weren't represented in the debate, but I think if you want to get some information, if your listeners want to get some information about the old Earth versus young Earth debate, typically the best known representatives of those two positions are Hugh Ross on the old Earth side and either Ken Ham or some of the folks at the Institute for Creation Research on the other.
Hmm. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Meyer. We really appreciate the work that you do there. I saw your presentation a while back at Ligonier at their national conference, going again this year to that conference. I am with a number of folks here as well, and just really thought that you did a great job in that presentation. Thanks so much for visiting with us today. We really appreciate it.
Well, thanks for having me on.
Okay. That was Dr. Stephen Meyer. Again, Dr. Meyer is with the Discovery Institute, and as I was pointing out, there's a couple of different websites that you can go to. I wanted to mention this one that he mentioned, darwinsdoubt.com. That's www.darwinsdoubt.com. You can go out there to find out more information about that particular book that he's written and some more information resources out there. Also, there was the discovery.org, www.discovery.org. And then finally, for Stephen Meyer himself, you can go out to his website, www.stephenmeyer.org. Stay tuned. We'll be back in just a couple minutes. And so don't go anywhere. I'll just leave it at that. How's that? We'll see you in a couple minutes.
You're listening to Knowing the Truth with Pastor Kevin Boling. For more information about today's program, the radio ministry, and the resources we offer, go to www.knowingthetruth.org.
When Charles Darwin finished his great masterpiece, The Origin of Species, he thought he had explained every clue but one. And the clue that he knew he hadn't explained, the piece of evidence that he knew he hadn't explained, was this absence of ancestral fossils prior to the emergence of the first animal forms, the first forms of animal life. The book is the story of Darwin's doubt, of his own doubt about the Cambrian explosion and what's become of it. Computer a new function, what do you have to give it? Code? Software? Instructions? Okay. All correct. Yes, check, check, check. Information. All right? And it turns out the same thing. This is the great discovery of 20th century biology. The same thing is true in life. If you want to build an organism, you've got to have DNA to build proteins, proteins to serve as cell types to make organs and organs and tissues to make body plans. We've got basically an engineering problem now. And the Cambrian explosion, more than anything else in the history of life, speaks to that problem because it's the first origin of the major animal forms.
You've been listening to Knowing the Truth with Pastor Kevin Boling. Knowing the Truth is the outreach ministry of the Mountain Bridge Bible Fellowship, located on Highway 25 in Traveler's Rest. For more information about the church and radio ministry, visit us on the web at knowingthetruth.org.
The opinions expressed on today's program are those of the announcers, their guests, and callers, and do not necessarily represent those of the staff and management of His Radio Network, the Radio Training Network, or Clear Channel Communications.